multi-wave order in all documents at the end of this talk. So this is a SQAP team in Paris, spectroscopy of quantum. This talk comes from the PhD of Bastien Loré here in the right circle. The PhD thesis and also his postdoctoral fellowship. So, as already introduced by Mathieu and Yvan, the old occupied phase diagram becomes increasingly complex with a long range charge density wave order inside the supporting dome, a short range charge density wave order just above DC, and the critical temperature. And above, we have the pseudo gap phase, which drops below the T star temperature. So here we'll focus. First part of this talk, we will focus on the pseudo gap phase. So the pseudo gap phase manifests itself by a suppression of low energy, which subsists above TC. This can be seen on this first graph, where here we have the energy distribution curve obtained from angular result photo emission spectroscopy from a BSP212 compound, which is slightly up. So the blue curve here corresponds to the superconducting state. So you can see a superconducting gap opening with a loss of spectral weight at low energy, close to the Fermi level, and coherence peak. But as we increase temperature, this superconducting gap is filling up. But above TC, which is at 92 Kelvin, we can see still a depletion here close to the Fermi level. And this is called this is a signature of the pseudo gap. Importantly, the pseudo gap is anisotropic. When we have no pseudo gap, we have a full Fermi surface. When we have the pseudo gap, the quasi-particles are destroyed along the principal axis of the Brillouin zone, which we call the antinodal region, while along the diagonal of the Brillouin zone, we have still a quasi-particle spectral weight here, which is called Fermi pockets, Fermi arcs, or Fermi pockets. Okay. So now I will try to answer to a very simple question: is there a connection between the existence of the pseudo gap and the Fermi surface topology? And especially when the pseudo gap collapses inside the superconducting dome. So in order to answer to this question, we have performed electronic Raman spectroscopy in two distinct regions of the bismuth-221-2 cuprate phase diagram. First, in the strongly overdoped regime, where there is no pseudo gap, where the pseudo gap develops below the pseudo gap temperature here. So, because we have seen just before from angular result photo emission spectroscopy that the pseudo gap develops mostly along the principal axis of the Brillouin zone, the antinodal region, we are probing now for exclusively the antinodal region. And we are looking at the pseudo gap. So, first, for the sample, here it's an overdoped sample with a critical temperature of 58 Kelvin, you can see a broad electronic background, which is a typical response for strongly correlated systems at 300 K. Now, when we decrease temperature, we can see that the broad electronic background increases and the slope at low energy increases. This is a typical metallic behavior because the slope at low energy of the Raman response function is proportional to the quasi-particle lifetime. And so when we decrease temperature, the quasi-particle lifetime increases in the normal state. Now we are entering in the superconducting states. And what we can see is a loss of spectral weight at low energy and a redistribution of a spectral weight to form the pair-breaking peak here. So we have a very simple Raman spectra of sample that we can and we can make a color map of its spectra as function of temperature and the energy. So as we cool down the system, we have a loss of spectral weight at low energy. This is the blue zone here, and we have also the formation of the pair-breaking peak, which is a red zone here. And we can see that the loss of spectral weight is not equal. There is no equality between the loss of spectral weight and the win of spectral weight, because in Raman spectroscopy, there is no sum rule like in optical conductivity. Now let's turn to the underdoped region of bismuth 2212. We have still a broad electronic background here, but when we decrease temperature, the slope decreases and give rise to a depression. And this depression is exactly the same depression that we have seen in angular resolved photoemission spectroscopy. And this of the pseudo gap in the normal state. Now, when we enter into the conducting state, we have this loss of spectral weight is enhanced, a redistribution of spectral weight at higher energy with the formation of the pair breaking peak. But if we look more, we can superconducting state with respect to the normal state. And this we call these depressions deep. Now, if we make a map of this spectra in the underdoped regime, it's much more complicated than the previous one. Because as you could, you have a zone here, the blue zone, where we have a depletion of the electronic background, which is a signature of the pseudo gap in the normal state, which is enhanced in the superconducting state with the formation of the pair breaking peak. But on the right energy side of the pair breaking peak, we have a dip. And this dip is the signature of the pseudo gap inside the superconducting state. Alors, the origin of the dip is still under debate. It could be a collective mode related to the pseudo gap, or it could be to the fact that the pseudo gap is particularly symmetric with respect to the superconducting gap, which is called symmetric. However, this dip only appears when the pseudo gap is there, and this dip is universal here. We have Raman measurements in one, which is a one side layer, and you clearly see a dip on the right energy side of the pair breaking peak. A little bit more complicated because you have some strong phonon which superimposed to the electronic background, but here you have the pair breaking peak, and here you can see the dip. It's more evident the bismuth 2, which is a two-layer point. We have a dip here, side of the pair breaking peak. And you have also a dip here in a mercury compound with three-layer copper oxide layer. OK. Now, our goal is to track the dip inside the superconducting state at 12 Kelvin and look at which doping level this dip disappears, which corresponds to the dip for which the pseudo gap collapses. So we have performed Raman measurement in bismuth 2212 and at low temperature, and we just change the doping and we increase the doping. So we can see a dip here. When we increase the doping, we can see the dip here. And then for higher doping level, we can see that the dip disappears in between 22 and 23%. So you can make a map. The fill red color corresponds to the observation of the dip, and the white circle corresponds to the disappearance of the dip. So at 12K, you can see the dip, and in between 22 and 26%, the dip disappears. The accuracy of the doping level could be surprising, but I can explain you in detail why we need to have deep. The third decimal, one unit in the third decimal corresponds to 1K. And here we have a difference of 4K, and we are able to experiment to see the difference between 2TC or 4K. So I can, during the discussion, explain you in detail, but the absolute value, of course, is sure, but the difference, the relative value is sure. So we observe the disappearance of this dip inside the superconducting state. And the red star here corresponds to the pseudo gap handline state. the measurement of the depletion as I show you before. So this measurement has been obtained by Raman by angular emission spectroscopy. We have even show exactly the same curve for the obtained by neutron. And there is also a measurement from a C-axis resistivity. We have exactly the same behavior. So all this measurement has been done exactly on the same compound, the bismuth 212. So the question now, to make the connection between the pseudo gap, the normal state pseudo gap, and the superconducting pseudo gap. So to answer to this question, we have performed Raman measurement as function of temperature on both sites where the dip disappears. So if we do that, we have to look very carefully on the right energy side of the pair breaking peak. So if you make a zoom of this part, you can see a dip, and this dip is still there up to TC. It never disappears. Now, if we look at 22%, close to 22.6%, and look on the right energy side, we don't see any dip. So this means that the disappearance of the pseudo gap is very sharp. Indeed, we have a very we have a decrease of the pseudo gap, and it collapses very abruptly inside the superconducting state. So I emphasize here that the disappearance of the pseudo gap in a discrepancy with a previous claim by photoemission spectroscopy, who said that there is a reentrance of the pseudo gap. I think the origin of the discrepancy comes from that this measurement has been performed on the antinodal region, where developed, but this point they got come from the nodal region and looking at the slope of the superconducting gap. I think it's something to do with the pseudo gap. All the measurements region where the pseudo gap mostly. Now, the question is, what is happening in the vicinity on 22%? Why is the pseudo gap collapses? So in order to answer to this question, we have performed a combined study between angular result for emission spectroscopy performed by Sergei Borisenko, and we can see dispersion curve at the Fermi level. And it's all like of 22%. If you look carefully, you can see that the Fermi surface is closed. So you have an electron-like Fermi surface. And this is confirmed by a procedure of the underlying dispersion curve above a broad energy range. If we look at the red curve, which corresponds to the antibonding bound, we can see that is we have an open Fermi surface here, and here we have a closed Fermi surface. Angular result photoemission spectroscopy tells us that the Fermi surface change of topology from like to electron-like when the pseudo gap collapses. But I would like to stress here that this fast topology can also detected by Raman spectroscopy, looking at the intensity of antinodal response function. So the response function are in green, and the Raman response function see that as we increase the doping level, the intensity of the antinodal Raman response function become very huge, very intense at 22%. And in the same case, the normal state, as we increase the doping level, the intensity and response function become huge in comparison to the node one. So we can plot the intensity ratio between the antinodal and nodal Raman response function, and we find a very sharp peak at 22%. And this 22% is the doping level for which the priority of the antibonding. And at the same time, the surface change of topology. So this is an indirect proof that we can also detect and achieve Fermi-Sieur phase topology by looking at the intensity of the Raman response function. So both angular resolved photoemission spectroscopy and Raman reveal a change of Fermi-Sieur phase topology when the pseudo gap collapses in bismuth 222. Now, I would like to stress that the pseudo gap collapses when the Fermi-Sieur phase change topology from all light to electron light is also detected in other compounds, especially in Houdini LSCO compound. This is data, and we can see so we have a pseudo gap, and we have an at 24. We have an all-like Fermi surface, but at 20%, the pseudo gap collapses, and you have an electron-like Fermi surface. Exactly the same came for the bismuth 2201. At the end of the superconducting dome, the pseudo gap collapses, and measure by angle-resolved photoemission dispersion curve, you can see that we have an Fermi-Sieur phase. And very recently, there is transport measurement, height magnetic field transport measurement from the Louis-Teisfer group under pressure on neodymium LSCO that show that the pseudo gap can only exist on all light Fermi-Sieur phase. So all these measurements are consistent with each other and come from very different groups. So our results. Following to our results, theoretical calculation based on two-dimensional has been investigated, showing that there is a connection between the pseudo gap and the Fermi-Sieur phase topology. I don't enter into the detail because Maria Carolina Egea presented these results last Monday. But in a very simple way, I can tell you that there are two regimes. The regime where the topological line corresponds to the change of the Fermi-Sieur phase merges with the pseudo gap collapses, and this corresponds to the of which are bismuth 2212, bismuth 2201, LSCO, and neodym LSCO. And there is another regime where the pseudo gap collapses before the change of Fermi-Sieur phase topology, and this is a case for YBCO, mercury compound, and also thallium barium copper oxide. So there is two different phase diagram. Here is T prime as function of doping. This has been obtained by the Antoine Georges group and Michel Ferrero. And this phase diagram with the same trend, mergence of the two line and split of these two line, which has been calculated by Maria Carolina Egea and Marcello Civelli. Now, I will stop here about the discussion of the pseudo gap, and where I would like to turn off our very recent result on the charge density wave order. So this is a very new result that we have obtained this year. So the point is the following: to detect the charge density wave gap in cuprates by Raman spectroscopy, we have to overcome two experimental challenge. The first one, as you can see, is the charge density wave order are inside the pseudo gap. And we know that the pseudo gap destroy all quasi particles around the principal axis of the Brillouin zone in the antinodal region. So, to get a chance to detect a redistribution of spectral weight inside the pseudo gap becomes difficult. Hopefully, there is a combined study performed by X-ray scattering measurement, by STM, by angular resolved photoemission spectroscopy show that the charge ordering vector connects the tips of the Fermi arcs. And the tip of the Fermi arcs are in the middle, in between the antinodal region and the nodal region. This gives us a chance to look at charge density wave opening, not in the antinodal region where all the quasi-particles are destroyed, by diagonal of the Brillouin zone. The second challenge, experimental challenge, is that we need to find a very clean copper oxide layer. And this is the case for the mercury 1223, because the inner copper oxide layer is protected by disorder by the two outer planes here. And this has been confirmed by NMR measurement with very sharp peak for this inner plane. And thanks to Dorothée Colson, who is able to elaborate very clean and beautiful single crystals of mercury 1, 2, 2, 3, we can try to detect this opening of charge density wave. And focusing on the spatial geometry along the diagonal, we have performed these measurements. So when we do that, finally, we succeed to detect a charge density wave gap opening. As you can see, as we decrease temperature, you have a redistribution of spectral rate from rho to height energy, so you have a huge hump here. And here we are above TC, the critical temperature is 117K, and we start our measurement at 120K, and we have this redistribution of this peak, of this spectral weight. We can also measure the temperature for which the charge density wave disappears by measuring the spectral weight of the amp, as we can see here. And the temperature onset of the charge density wave is about 250K. So we have reproduced this experiment at several doping levels. And here we have plotted the T onset of the charge density wave for different doping. So the red spot here corresponds to our data. And we have a dome-like shape, like you can see here. And we have verified that our measurements correspond to the NMR measurements, which correspond to the charge density wave order in this material. Fortunately, in this material, there is no X-ray diffraction yet. So be sure that we measure the charge density wave order. We have also used exactly the same procedure and work in YBCO and Mercury 1201. And we find we have two different doping levels. And for these two doping levels, we find a T onset for two different doping, which fit perfectly with the X-ray diffraction measurement and NMR measurements. We detect the charge density wave order. For the Mercury 1201, we have only one point here, but it also fits with the other data. So this first part just shows you that we are able to detect the charge density wave. But the main point, the main important point here, is that we are able to detect both simultaneously the energy of the charge density wave and the TC in the temperature onset of the charge density wave. So in Mercury data, in blue, this is the blue field triangle, we can see an increase of the energy of the charge density wave, while the temperature onset is a non-monotonic behavior because we have a dome-like shake here. And we have exactly the same trend for the energy of the charge density wave for YBCO. We have an increase of the energy while the T onset exhibits a dome. So this is an important point, but it tells you that the charge density wave order is not a conventional order. It's an unconventional order because the temperature onset is no more proportional to the energy of the charge density wave. And it looks like exactly as the superconducting order, where TC is no more proportional to the energy of the superconducting dome, as we know for a long time. Now, we can plot all the energy of the pseudo gap, this is a black star. We can plot the energy of the superconducting gap, this is a red dot, and we can also plot the energy of the charge density wave, this is a blue triangle. And what is surprising is to observe that the energy of the charge density wave is very close to the energy of the superconducting gap. And this relation suggests that we have probably an approximate emergence symmetry connecting the charge density wave with superconductivity. So I invite you to look at all this theory corresponding to this proposal of emergence symmetry. And I will thank you for your attention, and I will thank all my close collaborators on this subject.